amazing women that we've got on the panel today. And rather than me go off and pontificate on all these women, I'd just like to introduce them and get them out here as soon as possible. So first up, she is one mother you do not want to mess with. As the matriarch of the incredibly dysfunctional Sons of Anarchy family, she goes to extreme and, let's face it, somewhat questionable ends to defend her family. Please welcome Katie Sagal.
Well, Jack Bundy, woo!
By me, what?
Oh, yeah, she's B-Lex.
She recently wore a corset and was brutally terrifying on that plantation in 12 Years a Slave. You can find her on TV as a leader of the Witch's Coven, as an asylum inmate, or as a medium, depending on what season of American Horror Story you've watched. Please welcome Sarah Paulson. She's played 12, up to 12 different characters, all in one highly drama, and she makes each one of them so unique it's easy to forget that you're watching just one gifted actress. Please welcome Tatiana Maslany. And you may know her for her role as Rachel Robinson in 42, but it's likely that it's her star turn alongside Tom Misson in the surprise TV hit Sleepy Hollow that's caught your attention. Please welcome Nicole Beharie. She may be one of our youngest panelists up here today, but she's also one of the feistiest. She plays Arya Stark in Game of Thrones. And last but definitely not least is our final panelist, the woman who dreams of being queen one day, as Marjorie Tyrell in Game of Thrones. And she's continuing her ass-kicking skills in The Hunger Games. Please welcome Natalie Dormer.
Wow, we got two.
Oh my gosh, I love that person.
I know.
Hi guys.
Hi.
Nice to be here. So, clearly all the characters you play have made quite an impact with audiences, as we just saw. And what I'd like to know from all of you is, what was that first scene in that in the script when you first read it and you thought, I have to do this part?
Well, I hadn't really acted before and was really young, so it wasn't like I need to do this role. Or it was kind of just more of a hobby at the beginning. But yeah, I thought she was kind of similar to me. But yeah, my 12-year-old head didn't realize it was going to turn out to be this. But yeah, I'm glad that it has.
I think for me, in the first season of Sons of Anarchy, I got to take a syringe to Drea De Mateo. And it was in the most conniving and calm way that I threatened her life. And I've never done that, so I thought that was really something that I would want to do. Plus, I got to wear all that leather, so that was good.
Yes, she does. I guess for me, it was probably the scene in season two where Lana Winters had to simulate masturbation while trying to convert herself, to make herself a heterosexual, even though she was homosexual. That was a challenging thing to do. Wait for my father and mother to watch and everything. Really something. That was probably the one thing that made me know I wanted to do it.
For me, it was the opening scene of season one of Orphan Black. There's just the introduction of Sarah's character and of your character.
Okay.
I just wanted to be you, really. Of Sarah's character and her sort of, she wasn't likable in any way. Everything she did was sort of deplorable and really, you know, she, she wasn't a good person on the outside, and I really was drawn to that idea, and I was fascinated by her and wanted to embody that sort of criminal thing.
For me, the audition scene for Marjorie Terrell was the famous scene where she offers Renly Baratheon to use Loras in the room with her own brother, whatever will get it going.
Oh.
And I had watched Maisie season one of Game of Thrones, and I thought Thrones just wrote really three-dimensional, complex women really well. There was equality there, which was wonderful, so I just wanted to be a part of the show.
Oh.
When I read in the script that my counterpart asked the question, "So you've been emancipated," I figured, I think I should go for this and show them just how emancipated I am.
So, Natalie, I love that you've described Marjorie as this woman who uses the modern PR angle that's got like the Princess Di, Michelle Obama, hearts and minds thing down. And I just wonder, how manipulative is she? I mean, is it all about playing the angles, or is there like, there's some deep heart in there too? What's her motivation?
Where television is fantastic and is way ahead of film is it doesn't feel the need to polarize women so much. I experienced it in playing Anne Boleyn as well, that male writers, and I say this with all love and respect, often want to make a woman either the angel or the whore. Make her the witch or put her on the pedestal. And when people ask me about Marjorie, I say they're not mutually exclusive. You don't have to be practical and politically savvy and not be a good person. You can be a good human being and be shrewd. I think all these women play similar characters. They're not two separate things. Half of the people in this room are probably female. We are as complex. We are as complex and contradictory as the men, and Marjorie is a character that reflects that.
Yeah, definitely. Now, Maisie, your character has had a rough couple of years, and wandering on those hillsides, and it's not so good out there. And I just, that last scene that you had with the Hound where you walked away, it was just...
I know.
It was pretty incredible, and it seemed like it would be a transformative moment for your character, and I wondered how that was for you to play that. Is that how you saw it?
It was the main change in Arya so far. I feel like every year we're never sure if we're going to come back for another season, and you want a nice closure for your character, and I feel like heading into the new season, it's like we've just finished that chapter of Arya's life. That's who she was then. And she let go of everything that she kind of had before. And I mean, during that scene, I knew it was coming for a long time. And the way that it was done in the series, it's very different to the way it was done in the books. And I just wanted to know how people would react to that. It seemed to go down pretty well. It was a hard scene to do. It was hard to say goodbye to Rory. We spent so much time together this year. And he's such a great guy. And yeah, the scene, when I read it on paper, and when I came to set, it kind of just seemed to go really seamlessly, and we all sort of had the same idea of how the scene was going to go in our head, and when we got there, and then it sort of played out the way it did, it just felt really natural, which was great, because sometimes you have to change a lot of things to please different people on set, so it was nice that we all had the same idea for it.
Now, Nicole, you said that you've changed as a performer since the first season of Sleepy Hollow, where you actually were very affected by the storyline, and it was nice to see this character that was fighting for those that you love, and I just wonder what it is about your character in the show that you've so connected to.
Well, I have to say, initially, in my career, I've sort of played like historical characters, and I hadn't necessarily seen myself as being someone who would do an action show or a genre, because I just don't really see my type in that demographic necessarily. So I didn't necessarily see myself doing it. And then once I found myself in the part, you have sort of no other choice but to expand your possibilities, your concept of yourself. And one thing that I've come
across quite a bit, actually, is being on set, and there are, like, a lot of different men will sort of come on as date players or guest parts, and I recognize that, like, there's a certain strength that I have now, or a certain command that I have over, I guess, being the lead, one of the leads on the show, that I hadn't had before. So that's sort of, like, a huge thing, just sort of owning that space and not being expected as a woman to sort of shrink or curtsy or any of those sort of things, just sort of, you know, moving forward. Which wasn't necessarily my way, it's not the way I was raised, so.
And Tatiana, I mean, you experienced that too, as far as being number one on the call sheet, and number two, like, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, perhaps. But is it true that you had never played an adult, much less a mother, before you had done this part?
Yeah, I think the closest I got was, like, Mary, Mother of Jesus. But she was, like, 15, so it didn't count, really.
Right.
I had always played 10 years my junior, and this was a really nice, you know, stepping into my own womanhood, you know, in a similar way. Moving into a position of leadership and of responsibility as an actor and as the characters, you know. And the great thing about the show is I get to explore all the different insecurities that go along with that power. You know, Sarah's kind of running away from the fact that she's a mother and at the same time so completely drawn to it, whereas Allison is, you know, alpha mama. You know, so that there's a beautiful sort of gamut that I'm able to play with.
And do you have techniques for how you differentiate between those characters as far as make playlists for how you get into those different roles? Is that one way to access those?
Yeah, for sure. Music's a big thing for me. It's always inspired me in different ways. Dance has always inspired me, and because I wanted to come at the characters with a physical change and with a vocal change and a sort of internal rhythmic change, I went to music and, you know, found that a certain playlist would move me in a different way and give me a different palette of emotion to kind of work from. And it's the same way I think that, you know, you can look at a painting and you move a certain way. Music has that transformative kind of quality to it.
And Sarah, I mean, you kind of had a similar trajectory in that, like, each year on American Horror Story, he's just going to write you with some totally new character, right? And actually, I think probably next year, the character you're playing, maybe you could get some tips from Tatiana, considering who that character is.
I'm playing a woman with two heads. Yes, so I will be talking to myself a lot, and I'm going to be alone a lot talking to myself. So, I plan on keeping your brain alive. A lot of questions for you about how to do it, because I imagine it's going to be a challenge. We're only a week into shooting, so I can't really say how far down the rabbit hole I have yet to go.
But those characters must be two distinct heads, two specific personalities.
I think that information you probably have to come to the American Horror Story panel later on to find out about that. Yes, I think, there are things to be said there.
Right. So, Katie, can we talk about the end of last season? Do you think that the title of Most Hated Mother on Television is accurate?
I thought, I knew that was coming. I didn't know the ways and means that was coming. Concerned was the right, I thought there would be some backlash, and there was the exact opposite.
Right.
And the next day, I remember I went to a signing, and people lined up with forks for me to sign. The truth of the matter is that the reason people respond to the show is that they believe the characters that they're seeing. And so in the world that they live in, that kind of violence, that kind of response, and what it was that she did, it's not gratuitous. It's not something that you think, oh, well, they did that for shock value. You can actually see that would be Gemma's response to having her entire, in her brain, she believed her entire family had just been thrown under the bus by this woman. And, you know, so if you've been watching the story, you realize that that's where her loyalty lies. So, of course, that would be her response, even though it was in a rageful, not a planned response. It was just what happened. And if you've watched her trajectory, you can believe that that's what would happen. So I had no problem really going there. It made sense to me as her that that's what would happen.
And And what kind of things were fans saying to you when they were showing up with their carving forks?
Well, there's this really weird thing in the social media where it's Team Gemma and Team Tara. Team Gemma was certainly, you know, at the top of the heap, I suppose. You know, those that were, I'm sure there were the haters too. But you know, the truth is, I think, you know, we can't dumb down the audience. They really realize that they're watching a television program. So, you know, we can root for the ones we like, and you know, that's part of the fun of it. But you know, it wasn't like anybody, even though the fan base is very rabid. But you know, I think we all know the difference between truth and fiction, right? Entertainment.
So, speaking of entertainment, you guys have had to do a lot of physical things in all your roles and master different weapons, guns, carving forks, and swords, and supernatural powers and things like that. Are there any one that have been particularly challenging or particularly fun to do or things you really enjoyed as far as the training goes, perhaps the sword play, things like that?
So, in the books, Arya was written as a left-handed fighter, and I am right-handed, and when I started the production I decided that I wanted to do everything left-handed, stay true to the books, which started out as a bit of a giggle and it's good fun, and now it's turning out to be kind of difficult, but I'm sticking with it, and yeah, I mean it worked out fine, and a lot of the time I come in to learn a stunt sequence and it's been choreographed right-handed because they forget, and then I have to come in and say, actually we've got to change it all because I'm going to use my other hand, which is a bit of a nightmare, but exciting, and adds another twist to it, I guess.
Anyone else?
I particularly had fun whacking someone with a skateboard. That was one of my really fun weapons.
I recently did some really cool water work in a tank. Six-foot tank with a witch strangling and then dragging him down. That was pretty neat. Yeah. There's lots of like gas masks and stunt people watching you to make sure that you don't actually inhale too much water.
So. I've been having a lot of fun running around in the Hunger Games with a semi-automatic rifle. I was so ready to get rid of the silk skirts and the corsets, but now after 9 months of mud and dirt and, yeah, being really physical, I'm ready to go back to the silk skirts.
Natalie, in an interview I read recently, you talked about going out of your comfort zone when you're performing, and that that's kind of when you really get the biggest charge. And I'd like to open this up to all of you. About those times in your careers and in your roles where you really are pushing yourself and you think going in, I'm not certain I can do this, and how you come out on the other side, what that feels like.
This season we introduced a new clone, Tony, who's a trans guy. Yeah. And
Tony
Love, yeah. And for me that was a huge, you know, responsibility and a huge privilege to get to explore gender in that way. And, you know, our show's about identity, and so it made perfect sense for us to go in that direction. And it challenged ways that Jordan Pavaris and I, who plays Felix, got to interact, because we've had so many different dynamics between the two of us, and this one sort of went into a sexual tension. And to me, pushing out of my comfort zone, as soon as I don't want to do something, as soon as I have fears or doubts, it's like that's where you have to go as an actor, because then all the surprising stuff comes out of there. You don't know what you're capable of, you know, and I feel like we're in fear at all moments, at least I feel like I am, you know, you're kind of in survival all the time, so it's a natural state, I think, and as artists, I think it's the most fertile ground.
This is her first Comic-Con.
It's true.
It was really hard to play an 80-year-old woman. You know, not being 80, not being near that age yet. And
being very conscious that I didn't want to do a sort of caricature, sort of, all of a sudden I'm talking like you. I didn't want to do that, and I had the luxury of having had the 12 previous episodes prior to, you know, to shooting the finale, where I had aged to that degree, sort of behind me, and having experienced all of it in order. By the time we got to that point, I sort of felt like, as Lana Winters, I was 77 years old, and I felt somehow physically that I could just bring everything that had come before it to the table. But it was the scariest thing I'd ever done, and I remember Ryan Murphy being very concerned about what the old age makeup was going to look like. It was going to look really hokey and really shitty, and would it just ruin the whole thing, and I was worried about it too, and then it ended up kind of all working. I looked exactly like my grandmother in the most terrifying way. Yes, yes, it was bizarre, but it was very scary to do, because I just thought, if I watch this, and at the end of this journey that I've had with this woman that I did come to love in a way that I never have, and I probably never will, a part that I've ever played, I mean, I hope I do, but I think I'm lucky enough to have had it once. I thought if I ruin this now by doing some hokey, schlocky, old age acting class bullshit, I'm going to be really mad at myself. And so that was really, really hard to do. And I don't know, I had birdseed boobs they gave me, and I did a whole walk that was, I copied a friend of mine's walk.
What are birdseed?
They're just sacks of birdseed that feel like it's like big old tips that have kind of fallen down. It was really amazing. I kind of was always feeling, I was just like, wow, this is awesome. This is coming for me if I'm lucky. You know, I was, maybe one day I'll have a sack of birdseed. No, but it was challenging. But I feel similarly that the harder it is, the more I'm aware that I'm showing up and doing my work, and I can go home at night feeling like I've actually done something. I didn't have to worry about looking pretty. I mean, I didn't have to worry about being attractive to other people. I was playing a woman who was captured and who came out and killed everyone who got in her way, you know? So, I mean, including her own son, and, you know, it just wasn't easy, but I was really happy to be asked to do it. That was a long-ass answer, I'm sorry.
That was good. That's a bird's action.
Yeah, I just wanted to, you know, I'm a little bit afraid every year by some new thing that I, and it's just awesome to feel that way and to feel challenged. I can name every season, you know, having to be raped by a white supremacist or having to put a gun to a baby's head or do things that, you know, but I have to say the most terrifying things still are the very little simple things. When I have to hit some emotional mark, sort of out of nowhere it feels like, and I have to really be, where I am, you know, or somehow drum it up. You know, I had to do a scene yesterday that literally in a page and a half I had to go from A to Z, and I was like, I don't fucking know where this is. Oh. You know, and you're on the day, and it's television, so you have to go quick. There's no about, like, well, come back tomorrow, try it again. So those are still, but you know, as an actor, and for me, having come from comedy for so, so, so many years, where I was, the blessing and the curse of television is you get to be really well known as one thing, and then it's hard to step out. So I've been so blessed and grateful to be able to really, like, I would almost say every episode there's something really like, oh no, I'm gonna do that, and then you do it, and then you feel great, and it's just like, you know, enjoy. It's enjoying your job. It's having a good day at work.
And I do think there's something really crazy about any performance you see on television that's even halfway good is a testament to a really talented person, because it happens so quickly. There's no time. You know, you do a movie, you get to do 3 pages in a day, sometimes less, maybe sometimes a little bit more if it's in a lower budget movie. But on these television schedules, you're producing such incredible volume of material with no time. And so when you see these performances that are just arcing all over the place, and you're watching like 9 different people, or 12 coming. It's a lot of people, and like, you know, you're watching all everybody do what they do, and it's so hard to do well. It just, I think it's a real,
it's awesome.
No, I don't mean that. I do. I do mean that. I do mean it.
You guys kick ass. Tatiana, how many characters would you play today?
Three.
3 first season and 2 second season. Well, no, that's not true. 3. 3 is the most.
Is that your request? Did you request to have them do a fewer?
No, I think it just logistically was a nightmare.
Like, I worked it the first season, and I showed what I could do.
No, and then we did the 4 clone dance party. And that had to be, like, 2 days of, major choreography.
Nicole, did you want to chime in on this?
I think it's all been said. Like, you're not frightened, and nothing sort of drums up. So, you know, especially with how quickly we move, I found myself on autopilot. Okay, we have a problem, and that's when I just know I have to dig a little bit deeper. And I guess the circumstances of the show I'm on, there's a lot of loss and death. So I just kind of go there. I go where I need to go for it. Use personal things, and that generally takes me to a place that I don't necessarily feel comfortable. But I know once I'm in the trailer and I look at my hair later, I'm like, I'm a little nervous today. It's gonna be good. It's true.
Now, is there a, kick-ass emeritus, as far as a woman out there that you guys look up to in terms of role models that have done this before?
There we go.
Anyone else?
I mean, it sounds really hokey, but I feel like everybody on the stage, I mean, I really do feel they're all just kind of extraordinary. I mean, to me, I don't know. I don't know what you guys think. Leela from Futurama for me.
Anyone else?
The women on stage.
So, Maisie, you know, the first thing Emma Watson did after she finished playing Hermione was she cut off all her hair. She was so sick of, like, being a teenager and not being able to express herself the way she wanted to because she was Hermione. And I just wonder if that's something you relate to, being Arya Stark during your teenage years.
Yeah, totally. I mean, this industry, we have to be blank canvases, and I've realized that. And then when you get a role, they build on that, and you become that person. And particularly being so young in this industry, I feel like I have to find who I am as a person, like, anyway, and go through my teenage years, and also live in the limelight and, you know, juggle all of that at once, which sometimes does get really, really hectic. It's hard. I would love to, you know, do crazy things with my hair, and I recently got my nose pierced, and that was like all hell breaking loose, and everyone was like, Arya doesn't have a nose piercing, this is crazy. it's difficult, and, you know, to try and express yourself and be yourself, which is what everyone is constantly telling me, you know, just be yourself and be true to yourself. And it's kind of hard to do that when you can, because, for whatever reason. It's just finding the balance between the two, I guess.
But kind of on the flip side now, like we were talking about earlier, sometimes these roles allow you to do things that maybe you wouldn't be brave enough to do on your own. Like, maybe you wouldn't shave one side of your head. Up to you, but for the part, it was something that you were required to do, and then kind of get to like own it. It's something that it's probably really fun, I guess.
Yeah, the beauty of being an actor is that you find yourself in places, physically in places, or doing things or learning things that you wouldn't ordinarily do. And so we have a multitude of lives for the price of one. And that's the gift of being an actor. So, and Tatiana, like, times that, like,
So, if you guys could trade roles with any of your castmates on your current shows, Tatiana, it's kind of a hard question for you to answer, but for everyone else, who would you want to play if you could play somebody else on your shows that you're currently on?
Cersei Lannister.
We were just talking about this backstage because apparently there is a quiz online on which Game of Thrones character are you? Have you guys, anyone done this? Yeah. So you can go online and you answer some basic multi-choice questions and what character are you? And I did it, of course, as Natalie Dormer, and I was Arya Stark. I thought it was cool.
And I've never done it, but I have to now, and fingers crossed I get Cersei.
I think she's going to be Peter Dinklage. I think she's going to be Tyrion.
Who else would you want to be?
I would probably want to be anyone that Frances Conroy played. Myrtle Snow, for one, I would like to be. I would, you know, the Angel of Death. She was so amazing as that. And then, you know, Moira. I mean, she's. I would probably want to do anything Franny's doing.
Yeah. What about you?
John Noble on our show plays this. He's the son of Ichabod Crane, but also a grown man from 250 years ago. And he's sort of this conniving, deceitful, adorable, seductive man. I would love to do that because Abby's very straightforward, you know.
Tatiana, do you have a favorite poem?
Depends.
I mean, it must change.
Yeah.
Three times a day.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, it's kind of, it's all over the map.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Katie, does it ever, well, you must take your work home with you considering your husband is creating the show, that creating your character and all those things, but does it ever wear on you, that amount of violence that you're involved in?
You know, I'm pretty good about, you have three children, and you know, there's nothing like three children to really pull focus, and you know, it actually keeps things in balance and keeps things, you know, right-sized. You know, I think the way to do a good job is to not bring it home all the time and to, you know, just sort of let it lie. And I'm not super methody. You know, I don't walk around, you know, shooting my gun on scenes when I'm not in it. You know, there are actors that really have to sort of be that person all the time. So, you know, for me, and then my husband and I have found, you know, we've had to find a balance over these last 7 years where we, you know, we try not to talk about it a lot at home. So, you know, because it's so much of what goes on. And like I said, my children really. I mean, I definitely have emotional moments where I'm maybe a little bit sadder that day, but I think I pull out of it.
So Nicole, your Sleepy Hollow has been called out in a positive way because there's your relationship with Tom is platonic, and you've seen a lot of shows where that's started. Those relationships have started out that way. Do you think it's going to stick? I think they'll try to take it down the romantic path that shows tend to do.
I certainly hope not. That was one of the things that drew me to the project was that Abby wasn't defined by a man in any way. That she just interested, and actually that she was very disheveled, because that's how I lived my life, actually. So it's kind of nice to go to set and not have to worry about how you look and really focus on your intentions and getting the job done. It takes so much pressure off of me just as a human being and allows me to dig in a different way. There is talk of another character joining the cast that maybe is sort of like an interest to her, but we'll see. I think they have to work really hard to get her attention. So we'll see. Pardon. Shippers. Yes.
There you go. So being a woman that kicks ass, you guys have the right to get mad and be pissed off. Is there anything? Well, what is this about Hollywood right now? Just put it out there. Because there's a lot of
Sarah and I were just talking about asses.
We were talking about asses, yeah. And the size of
Hollywood
ass.
Seems to be anti-ass.
Hollywood's a little anti the ass. Yeah, like the size of the ass.
In what way? No one else seems to get it.
No, come on, we have to explain.
I'm not sure what that means.
They don't want
body image.
We were talking about body image and what it means to be a woman and business and to feel self-conscious about the size of one's ass, or lack of ass, or lack of boob, rest, whatever. I mean, there's a whole sexualization of women, and then also it's powerful too. I mean, it's, you know, I'm not
just... It's really interesting, because you said earlier, and then Nicole has also commented on how liberating it is to not worry, to do a job where you're not worried about how you look. And because the focus seems to be on that for women. And it's not fair on you guys, because you're watching us, and you don't realize how much makeup and how much lighting is involved. When we look good, we've got a lot of help going on.
And if we don't look good, that's just what we look like.
Yeah.
I often
think that it's not healthy for young girls to be flicking through these magazines and to be looking at films and TV and seeing these shows Spanish film, that they're a little bit more open to the quirks of human nature, that we're not all symmetrical, that we're not all one shape, you know, that people are oddballs in different ways, aesthetically, cosmetically, as well as emotionally and personality. And you need more of that.
And, also, that it's okay to get older. I would pipe in there about that.
Yeah.
Message. And that, you know, that's a pretty European thing. It seems like in Europe you can get older.
that's a really good point. Yeah. What I was saying before, so I'm not going to hog it, girls, you take over, but it's, you know, three Hollywood, like, films, features. The best female roles, I think, are in television at the moment. I really do. And other, and Katniss Everdeen is as popular as she is because she's an anomaly. She really is. Like, the... So... That's my point.
The sort of pisses me off is the issue of piracy. And I would just sort of encourage people to pay for their movies, to pay for their music, and to pay for those forms of entertainment that we all enjoy. Because the point of it is that, you know, it's very easy to see, to say, oh, a lot of rich people make that product, and why do they need this, why do they need that? But the truth of the matter is that trickles down to everybody. And that, you know, the artist needs to be paid, you know, whether you're the writer or the crew member or the actor, whatever it is. So, you know, the issue of piracy is a very big one. And I would, like, I encourage my children, I don't like them to go and, I'd rather give them the little bit of money to go buy a CD or to buy a DVD or to, rather than just get it for free off of some illegal download. It doesn't help the creative community to have people contributing to piracy. That's something that I would.
Exactly.
We're going to have two questions in a minute, but I just want to ask you guys one more question. What's the piece of advice that you received that you wished you listened to?
Don't panic. I hope my career goes on, you know, forever. And I think there's panic to, I don't know, to get somewhere that this is not a real thing. I think this is a lot of actory talk, but to get to an end result or a product and not enjoy the kind of mess and the journey, which is something, you know, to do with control and kind of, again, packaging, you know, this sort of, oh, I did it, now it's there and it was perfect, and then it's what the director wanted or whatever. I'm really fascinated with the idea of the mess and the mess being, you know, the art, and that is a thing you'll grow into your entire life. Don't have to get there now. It's a journey.
I might say, I remember somebody told me early on not to make choices based on your life. To first make choices based on your life, and that the work will follow. And, you know, I think that I listen to that more now, probably because I feel more secure and that I've continued to work for a certain amount of time. But as a young person trying to get something going, I feel like I slighted my life in a lot of ways, just in the name of my ambition or my paranoia that I wouldn't get another gig, or, you know, we become so self-centered in this journey of, you know, we're our own advocates as an actor. You know, you're your own sort of cheerleader. And so I think I might have listened to that advice a little better. Not that I haven't had a full life, but I think I missed out on some stuff when I was younger because I was so... you know, focused in that way. It was such a blessing to have a family. You know, at a certain point, you know, and I just kind of got them in there, you know what I mean? Like, I brought them to the set with me, and they, you know, I was able to do both things because I couldn't figure out that dilemma. How am I gonna have children and stop, you know? And I think as young actors, you know, we just have to do that anyway, and it all works out. But I think, so that would be the advice that I would give. And the
advice I'm going to take.
Yes.
Because I don't know what I haven't
listened to or what I've ignored, but that I'm going to take.
Oh.
I just, you know, I'm so afraid it's going to go away at any given moment, but you can't stop. Stop to do what? Have a life? Maybe meet someone? I mean, I what? I don't know. I don't know.
questions from the audience?
You're on. Good. Okay. Hi, my name is Kaza, and it's short for Kaza, a lot of trouble. Not really. It's the only joke I know. But I wanted to ask you, ladies, first, thanks for being here. And I do live action role play, which requires you to know a lot about combat, and I was curious what the most unique element has been for you guys to land stunt.
She's going to come back and she's going to tell us.
Live action role play is interactive theater, a book, a video game that has been turned into a live action event where you get to be those characters.
Oh. LARP game.
Any tips?
They're like, what?
Tips for your for the action stunts that you guys have done.
You go, Natalie. You've done them, haven't you?
Talk about that machine gun.
Yeah, I mean, actually doing it. I don't get to hold the sword as Marjorie Terrell, but I went to drama school with Nicole's co-star, Tom Meissen. We trained together. And at drama school in Britain, you do a lot of stage fighting, stage combat. It's like part of our classical thing. Because we're oh so superior. Tom and I used to do workshops at the Globe Theatre. There was like the Shakespeare Theatre, where obviously in a lot of Shakespeare plays, there's a lot of combat, sword fights. And I always couldn't get the authenticity. I didn't like the authenticity. It never felt right. So for a couple of years, I went and took up fencing. And actually doing it for real, like shooting a gun for real, is the best way to... I've referenced her already, but Jennifer Lawrence, when she shoots a bow and arrow in The Hunger Games, 9 times out of 10, she doesn't really have the arrow. It's CGI put in. Probably gonna get in really big trouble. I don't think that was the case in the first film, but I think for practical reasons, they found it better to add it in afterwards. But she shoots arrows, the real thing, for training constantly. Constantly, so that the action is 100% authentic when the arrow actually is no longer there. So does that make sense?
Yeah.
My tip.
Very helpful.
Yeah.
Okay. Hi, thank you for the whole panel. I was wondering if you could say your favorite kick-ass moment that your character or one of your characters has had. Not necessarily physically kick-ass, but personal triumph or victory kick-ass moment.
From an acting standpoint or from a character standpoint? Or
I was thinking character,
okay.
But either
whichever game. My character Allison in the first season had was forced into an intervention, which she rightly should. I mean, it was a good thing for her. But she sort of has this moment where she just just projectile vomits this stuff at all of her friends who've kind of cornered her, and it was such an exciting moment for her because she's so contained and so kind, only, you know, and sunny and together and perfect and pretty. So for her to get to just, you know, scream sketchy words at people was really a thrill, you know, and kind of a nice success for her.
My character, Arya, a lot of the time is very confrontational and never really very passive. She just comes out and says, what she feels, except for one time in season two. It's a scene between Arya and Tywin Lannister, when Arya tells Tywin that anyone can be killed, and at the time, he doesn't realize who she is and kind of doesn't think anything of it, but she knows at the back of her head what that really means to her and what that really means when she says it out loud and what that's going to mean to him in the future.
Oh, yeah. That was great.
Decides that she's going to be one of the witnesses and takes on her actual destiny. I guess throughout the season, they've been working as a pair, fighting as partners, constantly, demons, which is a thing. But finally, she goes in alone. I thought that was like a huge moment where she actually like believed everything that he was saying and decided to go in by herself to hell, basically.
Your favorite moment? Is that what your question is?
Yes.
Favorite kick-ass moment. I mean, I had a very quiet moment that I really very much liked, and it was in season two where she had been raped, and for the good of the whole, which is always her objective, which is the good of the club, she didn't tell the secret. She knew it would start a war. And then towards the end of the season, there was a scene where she revealed what had happened, and she reveals it to Clay, and to Jax, and to Tara. And, you know, it was a quiet scene, but it was a very, it was a powerful moment. And it was a very, for her, she's all about secrets, you know, for her to reveal that secret, so it was a big step. That was pretty kick-ass, I thought, for her.
The one that comes to mind immediately is the scene in the finale of this past season on Coven when my character's mother, played by Jessica Lange, died in my arms, and it was a kind of, they had such a contentious relationship the whole season, and the only way for her, for Cordelia, to my character to own her new supreme being title was to let her mother go. And to the only way for Jessica's character to let her daughter become what she was intended to become was to let her do that by dying. And so there was a kind of beauty in the selflessness that was happening for both of them, which never really happened between them ever prior to that. So I thought that was pretty kick-ass.
My kick-ass moment would be, I want to be the queen.
Yeah, I want to be the queen.
Hi, my name is Russ. First thing, Tatiana, I just want to say you're incredible. And I'm sorry that the end is closing. You didn't think that you don't exist. So my question is for the whole panel. I was wondering if any of your cast members on your respective shows have ever had a scene that maybe you wish that you could have performed yourself, and or if you could pick one, what would it be?
I don't know what that it would be, but the guys have a lot of great scenes. I'd like to be a guy sometimes. I'd like to ride a bike. I would like to ride a bike sometime. And, you know, I say that even though I'm actually terrified to ride a bike, but I sort of like the image of, you know, revving up that bike with a bunch of bikers. It just sounds awesome.
I kind of wanted many of Lily Rabe's Sister Mary Eunice scenes from season two, when she was able to be, she became the devil. That was really kick-ass. But I didn't get to do that, so.
Episode two, I think, of season two. Mrs. S she sort of shows her true colors and kind of murders a couple of people in cold blood, and the way she did it, I think I just want to be Maria, really. Anything she does is
amazing because she just has this stillness and this violence about her that's just so under the surface. It's amazing. I'd love to do that.
Again, John Noble tying people up on trees. I really desperately would love to do that. I would love like a magic power of some sort. So yeah, our finale with John Noble.
I'd love to just do more stunts. A lot of the time we have doubles that do things for us in case we get injured or whatever, which is so stupid, in my opinion. So yeah, I'd love to do more of my own stuff, and I'd love to do more work with the horses. I know Richard Madden, who plays Rob Stark, got to actually gallop, and like I want to actually gallop instead of someone else galloping for me. So yeah, I'd love to do more stuff with the horses. Rob Stark.
Oh God, I think I just want to be you.
Thanks.
Hi, I'm Colton. Tatiana just wants to say real quick that seeing your beautiful face has been good and you know, thank you.
Amazing hat.
So to all the ladies up there, if you had an opportunity to play any superhero or villain, regardless of gender, who would it be?
Oh yeah, that's a good question.
I would play Spider-Man.
She'd be awesome.
Spider-Woman. The typical superhero look is this strong, muscly, big character, and I like that Spider-Man is kind of agile and not that, and like kind of unsuspecting as well, rather than like coming out and like lifting up a car. It's like, I don't know, I feel like it's a lot more subtle than that. So yeah, Spider-Man.
I'd love to be Raphael from the Teenage Mutant. He's got that great, you know, Boston, Brooklyn accent or something. Yeah, that's right.
Little son. Deal.
I guess on the flip side, I would like to lift up a car. I probably would want to be the Hulk. Very quiet and unassuming, and if you press the wrong button, it's on.
I don't know if this is a superhero, but I liked Caesar in Planet of the Apes. Woo! Hey, Caesar.
Oh, they do too. Yeah. For me, it's probably Wolverine. I don't know, that's a really good question. I was always a huge Batman fan. The psychology of that man is so interesting, and it's why he's had so many reincarnations. I will always be a Batman.
There you go. The new superheroes.
Woo! Nice.
Hi, I'm Jess. My question is for Maisie and Natalie. Maisie, your character is seen as a very fiery character, and Natalie, your character is seen as a very resourceful character. And I suppose my question is, which one do you think is more ruthless in the series?
Well, I think the way Marjorie can manipulate characters is not something to be messed with. So it's for very different reasons. I mean, physically brutal. You know, some of the kill scenes that Arya has had have been vile for a 12-year-old to be experiencing that firsthand. It's awful. And I think we all like to turn a blind eye to that, actually, as well, which is something that I kind of wanted to bring up. That there's a 12-year-old girl that she, living in this world, and we all like to kind of brush that aside. She actually just put a sword through someone's throat and like, hey, that's such a kick-ass moment, which it is, but that's, you can't live your life like that and be okay in the head forever. Like, that's not the way it works. So then coming on to episode 10, when Arya does decide to leave the Hound, there is no real reason as to why. She's not sure what's right and what's wrong anymore, and there is really no right or wrong answer, because that's what Game of Thrones is. It's just these people that are desperately trying to, for whatever reason, gain power or the throne or revenge on their family, or, you know. And I think it's difficult to say that a character is good or bad.
Maisie's totally knocked the nail on the head by saying, and you have, it's an astute question, because the answer is Game of Thrones shows you all the different ways you can wield power.
Yeah.
Whether it's psychological, physical, sexual, dragons. Dragons, if you're given a choice.
I know.
But, you know, that's the secret of the writing. That's why it's such a compelling show, because it shows how different people are given different weapons, physically and metaphorically, and how they use them.
Yeah. Excuse me, Mr. Harlock, that's Captain. Oh, of course. But being a captain, there's one simple rule that you need to follow. What is that? I need rum. Where is the rum? I don't have any. Oh, bollocks. Well, maybe I'll ask Han Solo, since we're part of the same Disney family.